Good afternoon. I'm very happy to have the opportunity to introduce you to the second keynote lecture of today. My colleague, Professor Göran Sonesson, will be delivering the keynote. He's a very well-known semiotician already for quite a few years, if you don't mind me saying it. He's been very active in the fields of visual semiotics, cognitive semiotics, and also been extremely proactive in the association, the main organizations of semiotics. I would just mention the Nordic Association of Semiotic Studies and also the International Association of Semiotic Studies, which he has been Secretary General for a number of years. Were you?
I was Secretary General.
I'm sure that...
But may I be Secretary General of
the... Yes, Honoris Causa. Okay, anyway, he also directs the Center for Cognitive Semiotics in University of Lund, which is also his main affiliation, and his list of publication is so long that I will not even start listing. Luckily, there is internet for you to gather information. So, Professor Sonesson, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Yes. I hope that since the title of this Congress is Semiosis and Communication, I'm going to talk about communication, and which I think to be the same thing as semiosis here. And I think we have to add sedimentation, because sedimentation is the result of communication, and it's also the source of communication. And I'll explain that. I will do this, present this notion from the point of view of what we call cognitive semiotics. It's somehow a way of bringing together the big traditions of cognitive science and semiotics, or also linguistics, but of course linguistics is also part of both cognitive science and semiotics. And I'm not going to talk about linguistics today, but my feet doesn't really touch on it specifically. But cognitive science and semiotics, it's important because we don't want to put them together like that. We want to have a critical distance to both. So it's important to say first, what is the specificity of semiotics? It's the focus on meaning, which I think always have an experimental quality. Meaning is always something of which you have an experience. And more specifically, what we do in semiotics is when we look at differences and similarities between various semiotic resources, or if you want, systems, and also how they relate to each other. Today I will be mainly, I would like to emphasize here the differences between different kinds of semiotic resources, semiotic acts, are as important as the similarity. I think a lot of semiotics tend to reduce everything to the same model. All signification is used, all communication is sign use, and all signification is translation. Then we haven't learned very much about these notions. So, classical semiotics, as you know, is concerned with text, excluded in the context. It's basically concerned with synchrony, that's what causes simplification. But what we want to do in cognitive semiotics, absorbing the cognitive tradition, is to go beyond this idea of a pure autonomous semiotics and include knowledge from psychology, sociology, and many other disciplines. That is, often means incremental studies. But we also want to go beyond what we call meta-analysis, which is to reflect on experimental studies of other people, and also to make our own experimental studies. We have been doing that, but today my discourse will be at the more general level. And of course, this means that we have to relate semiotic structures on the one hand, and abilities and other psychic and social structures on the other. And what becomes central to us has become central to us. I don't think that's necessarily so, but in fact it has become central to us to study evolution and development, and development of course I apply them to children. We have very much inspired by work of Van Gogh, who is a neuroscientist, but I say that his work is more anthropological, maybe. He suggested that human development is different from all other kinds of development. You go through a number of states, which correspond to different kinds of memory. That's why the episodic memory is something of the brain, but all the others are somehow more or less outside the human mind. They are in society, between people. Or that's true about artifacts like pictures, sculptures and things like that. He placed them in the final stage with writing and theory, because we are principle independent of the organism. But before that, of course, we had to make imitation, gesture, and we had language. There's a lot to say about all this, but I don't intend to do it here and now. I want to concentrate on communication. And as you all know, this is the model which I think, unfortunately, is part of the heritage of semiotics. It comes from the communication theory, mathematical communication theory, and it was very much used by Jakobson and Echo, so we are somehow stuck with it. And I think it's not a very informative model of communication. Of course, you also have the Persian model, which is explicitly about the sign, but I think it's much better to look at it as the model of communication, at least in the spirit in which I'm going to present communication now. But let's try to build a new model, and if you have read my works, you know I presented this model a long time ago. So this is the idea that there is a subject who creates an artifact, but at the same time he sets a task to another subject to interpret it. So this is to say that what is important in the Shannon Weaver model, which is transport on the one hand and coding on the other hand, may happen, but it's not fundamental. The fundamental thing is that you set a task for interpretation. Now, I will use these guys now as to represent adversity and adversity. I hope you recognize them. We will turn to them. So, as I said, you can have different coding devices or transport devices, which is through the use of Morse code, a coding device. There is a transport, for example, in the case of the telegram. It's more difficult to say if the email is transported. It's more abstract sense. Radio waves, of course, are transported. All the things which are relevant to Shannon and Weaver at the time. But what really out is really what is really important, and that is what comes afterwards, or which must ultimately be there, without coding and without transport, that is the process of interpretation, which is here described as a process of concretization, some of which take place in perception, and it means that the two subjects have to collaborate for this to happen. So, okay. Now you can say that this model incorporates, I think, the Persian model, because the Persian model is about interpretation. And as I said, I think it's much better to look at this model as a model of communication, a process, than a sign. But it's much closer, I think, to what was invented by the Greek school of semiotics in the 30s and 40s, which I think is a very important but often forgotten tradition in semiotics. They took over the modern, in fact, from phenomenology, and more precisely from, not from Husserl himself, but from one of his main students, Roman Ingarden, who described how we experience the work of art. So what they did was to place this in a social context. So concretization, transformation of artifact into an interpretation takes place in a social context. Now, what I have done after that is that I have said that, okay, that may happen in art, but it happens all the time. All kind of communication is a case in which the subject, more or less, the addressee, more or less, has to interpret the artifact created by the adversary. And, of course, there is another important insight, which I don't want to emphasize here, and that is from the Tartu school, which says that in a process of communication, you always have to adapt either the sender has to adapt to the receiver, or vice versa, or maybe parts of both. So this means that somehow you have to retrieve the parts of the codes you need to system the interpretation which don't, the other have and you don't have. Because my idea here is that there's only parts of overlap in your systems of interpretation. So communication can be adapted to the target or to the source. Now, I said I want to try to integrate the tradition of cognitive science in some respect to that of semiotics. And it so happened that Michael Tomasello has defined something which he calls the cooperation model of communication. And I think the model that I present is exactly that. It says that communication is always a kind of collaboration. Now, we must put in the context of the study of the difference between human beings and great apes. And of course, in mainstream evolutionary psychology, you are supposed to act all the time in an egoistic way. I'm not ending this discussion, I've done it elsewhere. But there are three exceptions to that. And that is mutualism, when you can collaborate or you both gain from it. And there's reciprocal altruism. I help you now, you help me later. And then there's kin selection. You help people in your own family because we have the same genes. But against this, Michael Tomasello is insisted on the importance of cooperation with human beings. Not only in these contexts, but more generally, and that is rather unique to human beings. Because human beings can share information, and even great apes don't do that. You can get the apes to cooperate with a very concrete goal, like bringing the food closer to the goat can eat, something like that. But not to cooperate as just because you want to cooperate. So apes may share services, they may even share food in some context, but they never share information. The central information for them is, of course, where is the food hidden? That's why we can make some experiments and we try to show them signs where the goodies are found, but they don't understand it because they can't be. But he would tell if he knew the food was here. Now, as I said, I Thomas Sedo has this formula that human beings are unique, being both born and bred into cooperation. And I think that the model which I have developed, not here from the Facebook model, says exactly that, much more clearly than the engineer has shown. So I'm happy that there is a convergence here. The other aspect is when you are communicating, you always must suppose that there is some basis ideas on which we found this communication. We take things for granted, we share some resources. And this helped us communicate. But past communications also create new information which you can use, but the basis for further communication. So this is why it also leads the other aspect which I mentioned, that is sedimentation. Now sedimentation is something which comes from phenomenology, as it was characterized by Edmund Husserl. And he talks about genetic phenomenology, which studies the genesis and meanings of things within one's own stream of experience. You see here from the cradle to the grave, no? The experience we gather together. So we can plunge into layers of human existence that are pre-reflexive, passive, and anonymous, and still operative. So this is a process which also called sedimentation. And then there is also generative phenomenology, because that goes more beyond. It is more experience of a group, of a society, of a species. So it's a way of inquiring into how historical and intersubject structures themselves become meaningful, and how these structures can be generated. So it goes back. I mean, it's generative because it has to do with generations, but in fact, it goes even beyond that. Here's a quotation: "In distinction to genetic analysis, which is restricted to the becoming of individuals, creativity, a symbolic field of contemporary individuals, and intersubjectivity founded in an ecology, generative phenomenology treats phenomena that are geohistorical, cultural, intersubjective, and normative." So, as we will see a little later, this leads to a distinction of the life world we are taking for granted to the home world and the alien world. Very similar to the Tartu School's distinction of cultures and the art. Now, Husserl illustrated that with geometry, which has origin in that survey. So we have a practical basis for geometry, which is then much generalized. But if you have to understand geometry, you must go back to that survey. And what this leads to is the creation of this fourth category here, picture of rise and theory, and in some way also of language, that is things which are more or less independent of the human organism, but we induced as a support for human interpretation. And you can divide that in many ways, but I'm not going into these details here. I want to say something about translation, which I think is a very special kind of communication. Again, we have a heritage of Jakobson, Lotman and Kurz in the Semiosis translation. And of course all signs are translated into other signs for Jakob, for Kurz. For Jakobson there is translation proper, but also intralinguistic and intersemiotic translation. And Lotman talks about translation between culture as a kind of deformation. The problem is everything is translation when it's not clear what translation is. So I think we have to talk about the difference between different semiotic acts. Okay, I've said that. So the task of semiotics should be to explain the difference between different kinds of semiosis as well as the similarities. And that's why I argue that translation is a double act of communication. That is, you have a situation of sending and receiving. The translator is the receiver in that act, and there is another act where the translator is the sender. So this means that you have altogether four situations of communication, where what is taken for granted, what is a common ground, may be very different. So I think we can use these guys again here. And now we understand why we sit in that way in the middle, because we have to communicate from one language to another, from one culture to another. So translation proper, as Jacobson says, is certainly a double act of communication. Which means that the adapter to the target and the source may be different things in different parts of this process. And from this point of view, I think that interlingual translation in Jacobson's term is something very different. Intersemiotic translation is not so different, but it's still more complicated. Now, it's not said, you know, this formula, what it was. But I think, of course, there is always necessarily a certain deformation in translation, but it's wrong to understand translation in that sense, because the goal of translation is, of course, to find as much constancy and meaning as possible. So we are trying to have some constancy between these two acts of communication. And this doesn't, this is particularly true in the sense that the second act of communication must take into account the situation of both the sender and receiver of the original act, as well as that which is to be planned afterwards, in the second act. So if it leads to deformation, it's not because it's meant to do so. So this is unfortunate that in the top school translation is defined as deformation. Okay. So I think what is important here is all through this concatenation of communicating acts, the goal is to hold meaning as constant as possible. Now, intralinguistic translation, as Jacobson called it, and which I would prefer to call intrasemiotic transposition, is very different. Because normally, what you do, you substitute the new sign whose content is held partly constant, but whose expression may be completely different to be true of your reference. So what you do, is not defeat, but this sign is not quite what you wanted to use, because you're really talking about something somewhat different. So you look for another term. And that is quite different from translation. So you're regulated on the reference here, not on the other act of communication. You can think of intrasemiotic transposition also in another sense. For example, you try to explain something to a foreigner, to a child, or something like that, and then you have to find a word which is easier to understand. And in that case, of course, it's still more similar to translation, because it's regulated by the receiver. just like the address, you know, just like translation. But still, it's not the double act of translation or communication, because you only have two subjects involved. So what about intersemiotic translation, which I would going to call transposition? For example, the translation from language to film, or even the static picture, has to add a lot of new facts, especially the looks of the person, etc. This was pointed out, in fact, by Umberto Eco. So this means that there is not really a case of translation. You're not holding meaning constantly, you add meaning. Now you can say that to a degree, but it's also true when you translate between languages. Because, for example, in Finnish you have one pronoun, and in English and another language you have two. You have to decide if you're talking about the man or a woman. And many similar things happen between languages. We have Saussure's classic example of the mouton, which in English is lard or mutton. And of course, yes, this classic case of different words. We're talking about wood, trees, and things like that, to which Umberto Eco added some examples, and I added some more. And you see that the difference is very different here. So language also have this problem of that you sometimes have to add information that you can't possess if you were not present when the first act of communication took place. And there can of course be a difference in a more systematic level. For example, there is the discussion between of the difference with verb-framed languages and satellite-framed languages. For example, it is obligatory to explain the direction of movement from outside to inside, or it's not obligatory to tell if you are jumping or going or running or something like that. That's different between languages. So sometimes you don't have this information you need for the translation. And you can find many other examples. For example, in the Mayan languages, there is only one term for which we would call yesterday and tomorrow, because both mean one day from now. So you may have some problem deciding what it means. Now, when you discuss the difference between language and pictures, although he talked about art and painting, was Lessing, a thinker in the Enlightenment. And I think what Lotton is himself is still valid. His ideas were taken up by Welbury and Bayer in the late 20th century. Welbury translated them into Saussurean terminology and Bayer into Persian terminology. And then I tried to use these three thinkers together and be more critical about the results, and they were. I'm not going into all the details here, I have written about it elsewhere. But let's say only now that pictures can only render relative determinate entities. That is to say that you have, if you show an object, you have to show a lot of its properties. I added relatively because you can have different degrees of abstraction, of course. In language, you necessarily have to make abstractions. You only pick up some properties. And then Lessing had in this idea of language being better for describing events, and pictures better for describing objects. And that's of course some truth in that, but it's kind of complicated. And that also has some bearing on our capacity to tell stories. which I also think have been exaggerated. But you can also say that language has a more clearer thematic structure than pictures, because pictures show reality and as it's given in perception. So you don't necessarily know what is really in focus, what the point of attention is. Now, take this case. These are three films which are all retelling the story about Macbeth. And of course I can't discuss here how different they tell the story. Just think about the personage Macbeth himself. In the film by Orson Welles, by Roman Polanski and Akira Kurosawa, this is how they look. So you can say that there is a lot of translating going on, and translation has given rise to very different specifications. For example, how the crown looks, the shape of the head, the kind of bird, etc. You can continue a very long certain kinds of actions. Of course, normally you don't pick properties like that because you have a certain actor and then a lot of properties follows with the actor. Now in animated films, in kind of software you can use, you can actually pick the properties, but that's something rather easy. Anyhow, so given the difference of means, in this case, the transposition can never be identical to what is transposed. Of course, it can still be true, just as in ordinary translation, that the regulatory goal is to render the same meaning. But it's not certain necessarily so. We actually don't know. Did Wells, Kurosawa, and Polanski intend to convey the same ideas, the same objectives as Shakespeare? Would you only use the story for the old ends? That would normally never be true in a translation from one language to another. Could maybe happen in some very single instances. But if you're talking about transposition between different semiotic resources, that is a very important factor. That depends, of course, a lot of the genre, but it is very different. Okay, I said it. Now, the interesting thing is that I talked about communications as creating certain fundamental structure by means of sedimentation. And if you look at translation as a particular kind of communication, in fact, as a double act of communication, as a kind of all meaning constant, then you can see that this is another important factor in the creation and the change of cultures. One important event was, of course, when a lot of Greek thinking, philosophy, and a lot of other things were translated into Syriac, Halabi, and Arabic. And when they later were translated back into Latin, that changed first Arabic culture and then changed European culture. That is a big, very complicated, interesting issue. And I will try something easier, which is the incorporation of the Mesoamerican heritage into European culture. And here I think we have a lot to thank Frank Bernardino de Sahagún, who translated Aztec culture literally from Narrator into Spanish, but also metaphorically, I would say, as a transposition, in terms of pictures. So, what we have here is a translation which is not only translation between languages and translation between semiotic resources, but it is a translation between cultures. Now, this is my rendering of the original Trump's model. And you can say that what's interesting here to me is plus this idea of there being a mechanism of translation. Now, the problem is that if we post this model, what we have outside is non-culture, it's the barbarism. So that's at least in the Middle Ages how the people looked in other cultures. We have changed a little idea, but not much. So how do we look at ourselves? Well, I think this is the idea. Now, if you don't read Swedish, you don't understand anything. So I can translate it. This is a literal translation. And of course, you can also translate it culturally. And now I don't know, this is from some other lecture, so here we are people from many places, so I can't adapt to you. But you can always say that in any culture, the others are a foreign. So. So, in the case of conquest in America, I think this is an attitude you find in... make it kind of the opposite sense. Columbus, when he came to... Okay, so Columbus, he thinks of the others as barbarians, no? Because they are more like things. That's why I say they are part of Indian culture here. He puts the Indian tribes in the same list as animals, plants, gold, spices. They are different resources for the Spanish king. And he believes they have no religion, so. Cortes, on the other hand, treat them in a way as another culture, and that's why I call his attitude is the place an alter culture, something with whom you can communicate. That doesn't mean that he is nice with them, that means that he tries to understand them, and he uses his understanding better to impose himself. So, the first thing he does is to find interpreters. He requires the customs of Indians. For example, he finds out that they have a native resentment in the god, Quetzalcoatl. It's a white god who's coming from over the sea. So he, for a certain moment, managed to convince the Aztecs that he is Quetzalcoatl. He uses their culture. This is why I think we have to think of a more complex model of culture, for which there is two ways of being different from us. Either you are only things which you can describe like that feels really, or you are different but still you are speaking terms. So that's the difference between being an alias or being an actor. Now, the interesting thing is, how did Cortes communicate with the Aztecs? He talked with a Spaniard who had lived before in Mexico. He told him in Spanish, and that was Aquila. Aquila translated that into Maya, which he had learned when he stayed with the Maya. And then there's the Mayan slave girl who had learned the language of the imperial power of India, which existed in Mesoamerica before the Spaniards, that is, Aztecs. So she translated from Mayan to Nahuatl, and then for this chain, Cortes could communicate with Montezuma. Now, the case of Sahagun is much more complex. And there's a lot of details I could tell you about him, but I think we have to go on. The interesting thing is that he wrote the questionnaire in Spanish, in part in Nahuatl, which is the language of Aztec. And these students took, which were children of the powerful Aztecs, and the Aztecs, the nobles, which were in power before. And these students took the question to the elders, who knew the customs from before. The elders answered using pictures. I was from hidden resources or the creating of the sport. And the elders explained in a narrative what the pictures represented. The students wrote down these glosses in narrative below the pictures. And the student and Zaragoon and the students together transformed this into a Latin text in narrative. And the narrative text was translated into Spanish. In the third row were added to the logic and the information. And then I had two versions of this. One with pictures which looked very pre-Cartesian, and others which were much more adapted to European culture at the time. This is a complication which I have to develop. So, the interesting thing is we have here a questionnaire, and we go from that to picture writing and to glosses narrative, to running out of the text, but also to Spanish translation and the logical glosses on that. And in the final stage, pictures as illustrations as in European culture. So it's a very complicated process of both translation and transposition. So you can say here that Zaragoon had a relation of elders to students and elders. And actually had a relation of alias to a pre-Christian religion. That is, he had an acceptance of their customs. At the same time, of course, he thought that their religion was inspired by the dead. So, this is something which I discuss here. So, there is a difference here between culture. From the point of view of the knowledge you have and the value you put on it. So, he wanted to have his knowledge about pre-Hispanic culture, but from the point of view of value, he selected at least in the religious aspect. Now, the interesting thing is that the pre-Cartesian culture could not be completely stamped out by the Spaniards, because it was sedimented, as I said. Idols were destroyed, but some were hidden away. And these painted books, is what I inspired this way of doing the pictures. Some of them were hidden away, but a lot of them were created after corpus, all right. Okay. So, there is many ways in which this culture lived on, and it all has to do with the sedimentation of this culture. It could be the form of artifacts as sculptures, or it could be these painted books. And yeah, it could be a combination. Yeah. Anyhow, also the fact that motifs from pre-Hispanic culture were incorporated into paintings made by native artists in churches. It's important to think of these as a sediment which exists. So this is about the dialectics, if you like, between communication and sedimentation. And I would like to end by discussing the case which has been important in cognitive science. It was first proposed by Andy Clark and David Chambers. It's a story about Otto and Inya. both for going to a museum, but they had different ways of finding their way to the museum. Because Ina would do what most of us would do, she remembers how to go there. But it so happened that Otto has Alzheimer's, so he's written everything down in a notebook, and he follows the notes, the book. The argument in cognitive science is that they are really doing the same thing, only that somehow the mind or Otto is projected outside into the notebook, not in his mind, not his brain. So my theory is that they have the same function is because the notebook is constantly and immediately accessible to Otto, and it is automatically gone by him. Now this seems to suggest that the non-extended mind in a literal sense, can be bypassed. And that is not quite clear in Clark and Chalmers, but David Woodrow and Eric Meyer wrote a book which they called Radicalizing the Activist, Basic Mind Without Contents, where they clearly claim this, but really the notebook here works exactly as the mind. And we deny that any content is needed. We even say that sometimes we don't even need. I think that is absurd. There must be a mind which actualizes what is sedimented in the notebook, or nothing is there. Now, have we known anything about really people who have dementia? We do know that what normally happens is that people with dementia write down everything, but then they forget that they have written down, so they never find the notes. I would have experienced that. So, but more importantly, what is written in the notebook is meaningless, just like an unknown alphabetic script or something like that, if you don't have an interpreting mind. So I return to what I said before about communication as interpretation and as sedimentation. Where is the dialectics of this? And I think this is exactly where you can see that cognitive semiotics is very different from cognitive science. This is really the end, but after what happened yesterday, discussing yesterday, I would like to say nothing about what I would call the Petrelli Leone colonel. I felt I had to say something about it. I think that if life is an effort of the meaning, which is a term used by Freddie Bartlett, a psychologist, who was also that important from the point of view of cognitive semiotics. And if our task in semiotics is to reconstruct such meaning, we have to think that the word makes sense and that it makes sense to act in it. So we may end up having the same destiny as the dinosaurs, but the dinosaurs were not bothered by metasemiotics, to take a term from Susan here. Still, there must be an end to metasemiotics in human life if semiotic is to occur, and feedback is life is going to occur. Any action, also scientific action, is local. It takes place on the planet Earth, in this moment, in our life world, in our social cultural life world, or it doesn't take place at all. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sonesson, for this very interesting lecture, also for excellent topic. So we have some time for discussion.
And I guess we managed to have a couple of minutes for you to move from this place to your own sessions. So who wants to start? Okay, so up there.
That are things that are meaningless until they are found. No, they're not meaningless, I expect a difference, and just they have meaning potential, it just hasn't been discovered yet. It just hasn't been interpreted.
You think about philosophy here, the issue, or?
No, about the conclusion, about what takes place in our, if it doesn't take place in our world, in our interaction, it doesn't take place at all. It doesn't have meaning. But I think there's still meaning to anything, but it's just, it has potential, but it hasn't been discovered yet.
I'm not sure I recognize that. I mean, I talked about sedimentation. Of course, sedimentation is potential meaning, but you have to reactivate it, yes. You mean that?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't think there's anything which doesn't have any meaning. That's exactly the problem I have here.
Okay. Can I just interpret that?
Sorry. Okay.
Thanks very much for this presentation. Briefly, a curiosity. In my opinion, cognitive semiotics, and might I also say moral semiotics, present some good arguments refuting the idea that culture shapes cognition thoroughly, the so-called something called hypothesis. And yet I feel that I identify that. I feel that it's present sometimes. What is your position? In general, to the idea that culture shapes thought, to what extent? Some people work like this.
The culture shapes
thought, cognition.
Okay, I do think it does shape cognition to some extent, but there is certainly a lot of invariance in human thinking, for example, opposed to thinking of great apes. I think we know it. And now I have to talk about our experimental studies, but we have been studying the apes of children. And I think we have learned a lot about the difference with thinking between apes and human beings, but also between children at different levels of development. So, absolutely, yes. I mean, but of course, there is also cultural difference, but basically I think thinking is beyond the culture. But of course there is some issues with the culture, that's why we have this problem of translational transition.
Yes.
Thank you for your very interesting presentation. I would like to ask you about the applicability of what you pointed out. Do you think in our times, when we are neighbors with people from abroad, from very, very different geographical spaces, with very, very different backgrounds, do you think it is an issue, yes, transposition, not only linguistically, but usually epistemologically.
Absolutely. Actually, I mentioned immigration. Yeah, immigration, I mentioned that as a problem of culture, because that is, of course, the problem not only that many people in the host country treat immigrants as aliens from the land, as barbarians, but also vice versa. That's an important factor, as Vanessa mentioned, and that is a serious problem of how to make the translation. The whole transposition of cultural behavior, if it's at all possible to me.
And I think it's a very, very much, actually I've written, but not so much, it's a book which is called, the name which is Human Life for Us, which is an anthology, where I have written several chapters, also my students' comics have written them, and where I talk about immigration as one of these factors of encounter between cultures.
Thank you.
But I would like to do more about it.
Okay.
One last question, perhaps?
And
we'll conclude with.
Just a curiosity, who is portraying your name? Petrelli. You're not referring to me yet.
Yeah.
Oh, my name is Petrelli. P-E-T.
Oh, so sorry. I'm not really.
When you were talking about translation, you were saying, you gave the example of Shakespeare, translations of Shakespeare. Were you saying that it was necessary to ensure that the interpreted in Shakespeare's notation? I wasn't quite sure what you were
What I meant is that a translator normally tried to render as faithfully possible what was written in another language. That may be exceptions to that, but it's a normal case. But if you make a film and your film is based on some of Shakespeare, it's not certain that you're really much conveying the same idea as Shakespeare in other, quite other words. So it's not so easy to make this analogy. And of course, that's only one of the things, but even if you do want to say the same thing, there are so many things which you have to add or subtract to make it feel out of the written text. I'm sorry about your name, but I've read this this morning when I, before coming here.
That's okay. So, concerning this issue about translation, a category that we have introduced is when we translate, it's a question of translating the same other, or the same other. I entitled one of my many volumes dedicated to translation theory, Lo stesso arco, the same other. Umberto Eco liked that, he comments on that in his book, Dire quasi la stessa cosa, fully aware that his title to say almost the same thing is not as good. Because the point is that in translation, in this case interlingual translation, yes, whatever the translation is can be very, very different and is developed in the dynamics between the same other. You should be able to identify, let's say, the source text. So you know that is the Merchant of Venice, for example, which does not, however, exclude the possibility of translations, reinterpretations, recreations, whether in another text or film, etc. So I think this paradigm, the same other, is very, very helpful in explaining what happens what can happen in the translation process.
Okay, but this was not really theme today, but another text I'm talking about two kinds of alto. There is alto and there is alias. With alto you have some mutual exchange, and with alias you see from outside. So I think it's important what kind of alto you are addressing. So I'm deeply interested in otherness. But I think I want to make other distinctions.
Yeah, I would agree. This is what I was saying yesterday too. Otherness does not mean one thing only. We need to understand each other and understand what we mean when we say otherness. The same with a whole series of terms, language, communication, and so forth. And of course, we can't do that here because we never finish. concerning this, I don't quite understand what the conundrum is. If you want, I can comment what you've written.
I would suggest we can continue. We're doing coffee break. I guess everybody has to reach their own session. So I'd like to thank you, everybody, for coming.